helped paint them, so you're welcome. And I already can tell you're a better audience than I introduced to one couple noon, and they were like dead. So I think they'd had turkey an hour before. I'm not sure. They were suffering from tryptophan. Just real quick, before we kick this off, I want to go ahead and thank our presenting sponsors who helped make this all possible. The City of Sedona, Mary D. Fisher, the Kling Family Foundation, BMO Harris Bank, Portia North Scottsdale, the Exposures International Gallery of Fine Art, and Northern Arizona Healthcare. And I especially want to thank BMO Harris Bank because they are the sponsor of this particular theater. They were last year and they are again this year. There's a whole page of sponsors in the program. No, I'm not going to read them all to you, but I'll just highlight three that I want to thank this morning, and that's The Sweetery, Photographics, and SedonaArizonaVacations.com. And especially want to thank the hospitality industry. They are providing over 1,000 room nights for our filmmakers while they're here. And then the restaurant industry here is providing 2,000 meals. So let's give them a round of applause. I was going to do my Jeb Bush and say, please applaud. I also want to thank our members who make a difference and sustain our organization. If you're not a member, we lock the door till you join. No, that's not true. But we do have membership information and application available out in our lobby. And I want to thank our staff and our board and our over 200 volunteers who help make this festival possible. You're here this morning for one of our filmmaker conversations, obviously. Invite you to come back again tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock, free, and it's going to be on producing and directing, so it should be another wonderful panel discussion. Also want to thank White Tie Transportation, Pink Jeep Tours, and Red Rock Magic Trolley. They're providing the shuttles between the parking lots and our different venues. You've probably already heard about it, but you get to hear about it again. New this year is our Red Carpet Raffle. We have daily drawings, and so tickets that are purchased today will be entered in tomorrow's drawing for a $500 gift certificate from Talakapaki, and as well as lessons on how to pronounce that if need be. Tickets are $20 each or six for $100. I would ask you to turn off your cell phones at this point so we don't interrupt the panel during the discussion. And then if you've not been to our theater before, we're probably about the only theater in North America where the restrooms aren't off the lobby. If you go out there, you won't find them. They're actually off this back corner, so the javelina points the way for you. So I invite you to sit back and enjoy this morning's discussion on screenwriting. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our moderator for the day, as well as, and she'll introduce the panelists, Jerry Ray Mansfield.
Hi, thank you all for getting up this early. And I know you were probably all up anyhow, but it's still early. And what a great crowd. What a fabulous, fabulous crowd. I'm going to take a seat while he brings the rest of the friends up here. Can you do that?
I don't have their names.
Oh, you don't have their names? Okay, well, sneak out one at a time in whatever order you're in.
I'm Daniel O'Connor.
This is Daniel O'Connor. And your film? Which is playing this afternoon across the street. Tomorrow at noon. And they were at Austin, by the way, so he likes these sort of westerny towns.
Hi, Marion Cohn, the film is The Girl in the Book. It's playing tomorrow at 9 a.m.
So you, yeah, either go to that or come to the panel tomorrow.
Hi, I'm Tony Schmeichel. My film is Hybrids. It plays Thursday with the kids, for the local school kids, and then Saturday at 3 p.m.
Okay, thank you. No, you have to go in the middle. What are you doing? Get in the middle. Jeez. You know, they make a movie and suddenly they think they own the joint. I'm Jerry Mansfield. I own a company, co-own a company called Monterey Media, Inc. We've been in business over 30 years. We distribute only independent feature films. We do not do anything but narrative films. We do not do documentaries. I have a lot of experience in documentaries, but because we're doing so much theatrical these days, we start with theatrical and go all the way through digital, schools, SVOD, everything, and cable. And so we find that the docs are a little hard to wrangle in the midst of all the narrative films. So if you have doc questions, I can help you, but I'm sure one of them has experience because almost every filmmaker starts with a doc. Okay? So there we go. Again, thank you so much for coming out for this. How many of you have ever written a screenplay? That's not bad. How many of you have ever made money writing a screenplay? Okay. See, that's why you're here. How many of you want to write a screenplay? And how many people just wanted to meet me? Never works. Okay. I think that we should start a little bit with the process and how the process begins, because I think all of you that have written a screenplay or want a screenplay, somehow you get an idea and then you want to begin. So we're going to take microphones down this way, ladies first, of course, and talk just a little bit about the process of writing the screenplay, how you get the first ideas, how you begin, okay?
I think probably everybody's different, but I actually find getting the idea or falling in love enough with the idea to write it the hardest part, particularly once you've gone through a filmmaking process and you know how long you're going to be living with that idea. I think that actually I do a lot of different kinds of writing, and I think the thing that's unique about screenwriting is that it's so much about structure, getting the structure of the film right, you know, having the right arc, and you can't sort of just wing it the way you can and explore it as you write. So I think that process of falling in love with the idea and then getting the structure down so that you at least know where you're beginning, where you're ending, how you're rising, so that you can write through it is the hard and necessary part for a screenplay.
I agree pretty much everything she said. What happens, though, is after you get this idea and you write it down and the three-act play, so forth, it changes. It just continually changes as you go along. Everything changes. The ending, at least for me, the ending changes. The 30th page changes. So there's a continual. What happens is it begins to write itself. Your characters begin to become real, and they start talking to you, or at least to me as a writer. And basically, good screenplay writers are people that can make up a lot of good shit. So that's my way of going about it.
So if you're a good liar,
So for me, my first screenplay, and coincidentally my last, was basically the thing they tell you in film school is write what you know. So that makes it easier if you have a topic that you know pretty darn well because you've lived it. But then you've got to make things up. And for me, that's the hardest. I've done original screenplays. I've adapted books. I've been assigned projects. And those are much easier than writing an original. But the most important thing, really, is you can have the idea, you can write it down, but you have to get up every morning and actually write. So it means putting your butt down in a chair, whether you feel the inspiration or not, and do it. It's interesting. Some days I feel like, oh my God, the muse is with me, and I just knock out 10 pages, and I think it's amazing. I don't go back and reread the thing the next morning. That'll stop you dead in your tracks. You just got to keep moving forward. But some of that stuff, when I feel like the muses are with me and I look back at it, it looks ridiculous. And then there are days which I just cannot think of anything, but I say I have to write something. So I just start writing words, it seems like the most banal things I've ever written, and I look at those 3 or 4 days later and I say, wow, that's pretty good. So it really is a 9-to-5 job or a 2-to-3. 2 to 7, or for me, I actually work much better in the morning. I'm usually done by 1:30 or 2 because I start to fall asleep. So it's getting up in the morning and doing it. And recently I haven't, but there's so much internet and so many reasons not to write. So I actually found a cottage with no internet reception, no telephone, and I borrowed that place, and that's where I really get work done. And actually I can work past 1:30 and 2.
Thank you. I have my own mic. So lots I could expand upon. I guess write what you know. I was thinking about my first two features. My first feature was about a guy who gets replaced at work by a good-looking robot, and I haven't had that happen. And my second feature is about a guy who gets magical glasses. I haven't had that happen. But if you go behind both those movies, I do know what it's like to be jealous of somebody and to be striving for someone's affection and have somebody being better at that. And I do know what it's like to make mistakes and to want to be able to tell the true nature of people, as it happens in my movie about the glasses. For me, I agree with what Jim says. It's all about having a great idea and then just sitting down and writing. And my own personal process is to write for four hours a day, but I block off 8 hours to do that because I spend about 4 hours procrastinating. You know, it's true. I build it into my time because I know it's going to happen. So first I'll go for a run, and then I'll have breakfast and read the paper, and then I'll sit down and I'll email somebody, then I'll go on Facebook, and then this 2.5 hours is gone. I was like, okay, I guess I'll write something now. And then I'll just keep writing. And, you know, I think some of you are here for some advice. And one little piece of advice I would have is just write and don't judge it as you write it. Just write it and get it down. And then, you know, the first draft they call the vomit draft. You just get it out there. And you know that a lot of it sucks and won't end up in the movie, but you feel successful because you've written some pages. And that's really, really important.
Wow, you've got a nice overview there. You've got structure. You've got tell the lies. You've got write what you know, and just get through it because it's going to be very painful. So I especially like the vomit draft. Yeah. I like that a lot. So everybody note that, you know, when you have it, just write the big words on it. I have a list here from a screenwriter friend of mine that I find pretty interesting too. I think the most important question and answer, because I'm going to answer it first, is what exactly makes a good story and a good script. And I have to tell you, while you write what you know, there's an old, I think it's a screenwriter joke, it might be a Broadway joke, but I think it's a screenwriter joke that tells about a gentleman who goes around when video first comes alive and he's videotaping his life because he just has the most interesting life in the world. And everyone should know this. And he gets into it for a couple weeks, 3 weeks, whatever, and he realizes that it would take someone else their entire lifetime to watch his life. So that doesn't work. So I have to tell you, while you're writing a good script and you're writing a story you know, be sure it's a story that someone else is going to care about. You know, everybody tells stories about their kids, their grandchildren, their dogs, whatever. But unless you let those characters come alive, as these people say, and tell their own stories, you're going to have people yawning. And believe me, I've sat through many of those. So here we go. We're going to talk about what makes a good script, what makes a good story.
You can pass if you want to. You can pass.
I guess I don't feel like that. I mean, I don't quite feel like that's my job. I just do it and then hope for the best. I kind of have to disagree with you. I think that the only way you can do it is if you believe that if you care about it, you're a human being, other people are human beings, and they're going to care about it too. That's the only, I mean, to get yourself to do it and take that leap is so terrifying every time that if you don't sort of assume that if you care, they'll care, then I don't know that you can get past it. So, yeah.
I'll tell you by example. I was going to start my first screenplay. I have 8 now finished features, but the very first one, which, by the way, has not been produced. I was writing it, and I said, oh, great, I'm going to get this out to the people, and everyone's going to love it, and they're going to give me money, and they're going to make my movie. And, of course, that doesn't happen like that. So, and then my friends in Hollywood said, Tony, you know, you're way, way, way over the limit as far as ageism in Hollywood. So you're really fighting an uphill battle. So I thought, okay, what am I going to do? Now, I got this screenplay. I can't, if I go myself and present it to someone, I'll be out the door in 2 seconds. So what can I do? Oh, I know. I'll get my stepson, who's in his 20s, and I'll make him be me, and he'll go. And I went, yeah, and I thought about that, and I went, wait, you know what? That's a good idea for a story. So I wrote a screenplay based on that, okay? So where the character, the old guy, became the agent for the young guy who didn't write the script. And that's how that started. So it can happen, you know, in so many different ways. So that's an example for mine.
So I'm not sure I know the answer to that question. But I think it's true. You write what you care about. And if you really care deeply about this, hopefully other people will too. I find character, for me, I like writing character and dialogue. I have a hard time. Plot is really hard for me. Making shit up is very difficult for me. But you, on the other hand, you have to. I mean, when I say write what you know, you have to, you know, start with the seed and the thing that you care about and that you know deeply. But again, yeah, once the characters start to take over and they do things that you didn't do, or this person, you know, that you know didn't happen, you have to let it go if it makes sense and it's integral to the story. So you can't be bound up by, oh my God, that really didn't happen, unless you're saying this is an absolute true story. But just write what you care about and don't worry. I personally can't worry about what the marketplace wants, especially these days, because that's not what appeals to me.
For me, I think any good movie that I've enjoyed, I've had an emotional connection with, either laughed a lot or it moved me in some way. So to me, a good story is one that connects with your audience at an emotional level. And you can take it away and you can think about it, and it connects with your heart.
I think underdogs make a good story. Everybody wants to feel like they can do more than they've been able to do, or they feel like they've been up against forces that are stronger than them, that are holding them back. I think I take it back. Underdogs make a good story.
Thinking about it, I guess the one other thing that I think about is, you know, it, which I sort of started saying, you know, screenwriting is such a specific kind of writing. And I guess the one thing that I would say I think makes a good screenplay is if you use what you have in screenwriting. So that one of those things is structure, and the other is that, you know, it's a visual medium. You can't write what's inside people. You have to show it. So, I mean, I think that's the other thing. If you manage to put everything into what people are doing and what you're seeing, and you know, and realistic dialogue, so that you're using the medium to its advantage. That's probably.
I have two films here at the film festival: Yosemite and Memoria. They were both written by James Franco and a co-writer. He has a new business, a new facet of his business, whereby he mentors young filmmakers, and we and another company called Elysium Bandini are putting these films out for them, because it shows first-time filmmakers and it shows a lot of the process and where those stories come from. These stories all come from James Franco's life, and then he's embellished on the characters. And he says that the reason he was able to write them now, and they're from his books, California Childhood and Palo Alto, and he's written several books. And the reason he's able to look back at them now and hand them over to someone else is because he's had the time separation from them, and he now understands how important those events were in his life so many years ago. Events with a parent, a step-parent, a chance meeting of someone, peer pressure, all of those things. And that's something to take into consideration, I think, as all of them say. I don't think you always have to tell the truth, because I've watched James's books and I look at some things and I go, now James, and he goes, oh, no, that's just storytelling. So that's kind of good too. But adapting from a book seems to be a really good thing for a first screenwriter too, if you can get rights to a book. I had a talent up here with, my other film's not Memoria, it's Burning Bodhi. Memoria was the last festival. This is Burning Bodhi. I'm so sorry. A beautiful actress named Cody Horn was up, and she had just come off a Broadway play this last week. And we were sitting at breakfast with the writer and the producer, and Cody and myself, and she was talking about this play, and she said she's bought the rights to adapt it. It's a very short play. It's a very simple play. And the writer who wrote her story, Burning Bodhi, who is extremely articulate, has written many things and had them all published, and also teaches a screenwriting class, turned and he said, how are you going to open that up? I don't get it. And that was really interesting, because she sat and diagrammed how she was going to open it up, and it sounded perfect. So not everybody will see what you see. And that's why I like everybody to give their point of view, because not everybody will see what you see. And when you get around to having to pitch it, and you want to hire your nephew? Was that it? Son? Stepson? If you want to hire a relative to pitch it for you, remember, they won't tell your story. And when you hand it over to an agent, they're not going to tell your story. So you need to tell your story. And also have a really, really hard shell, because it's going to get changed 15 times. And I have Allie Walker calling me from one of our other films. I have some things here that I want to go over and see if these are things you want to cover. Do you want to discuss length, script element, scene heading, action, character name, dialogue, extension, transition, shot list? Or can you get all that out of books and just hear experience?
Yeah, go ahead.
Just keep going. Okay. Do you need to discuss the finer points of dialogue and how people will ad-lib once they get your script? Okay. Let's go to that one. I need people here who've had films made to discuss that, okay?
I would say that I'm always open to actors creating on the set, but it hasn't happened very much. Usually the process of getting film finance takes so long that I can do a lot of rewriting, and I'm pretty happy with it by the time we get to the set, so.
For hybrids, because it's a story about tolerance, respect for other cultures, and love of family, but it's teenagers, parents, and grandparents. So, okay, how do I write this? Well, there's the internet now. So when I was writing the dialogue for the teenagers, I not only talked to my grandchildren about it, but I go on the internet and see what words were being used today by teenagers, and I would incorporate that into the dialogue for the teenagers in my story. Of course, I knew what the old people were saying, and I knew what the parents, because I had six kids myself. So, but that's how I work at the dialogue. And I, you know, when you send your scripts out to competition, you know, you get back things, oh, it's too stilted, or it doesn't make sense, or that's not how this person would talk. Well, that's probably true, but the idea of having the actors, when it gets to that, your script changes, the director changes your script, and then the actors will suggest things. Not that you as a producer or an executive producer don't have any say about it, but most of the time, they'll be giving you good advice, and I would listen to the actors on that. You don't have to take everything that they give you, but a lot of times they're going to be right about it. So that's how I work with the dialogue.
And can you elaborate a little bit more on that, because you have a very seasoned actor,
Paul Sorvino. Yeah.
And can you talk about that with his process and what he?
Well. The way we did it with Paul, because Paul insisted on it, the actors, before we even shot each day, would rehearse. They would take the time, enough time, hours, 1 hour, 2 hour, and I would be going crazy because I'm the producer and they're wasting time. But once,
which means you see dollar bills.
Yeah. Yeah.
I just had that image as you were saying that.
And I'm also the writer, so, and I'm listening to all of this ad-libbing and my words, you know, going away and new words being replaced. But the idea was they took all this time. Paul insisted, and they went through the dialogue. And by the time they finished, when we got ready to shoot the scene, it went boom, 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 boom.
Time was spent.
Yeah.
So I've directed almost everything I've written. This was my first feature, but I've been in Los Angeles doing TV movies and miniseries and pilots for about 30 years. And I have to, my blood pressure went up when you guys started talking about this, because I find when I write dialogue, I think about that line, that word, that's been, you think about it a long time, a lot longer than usually the actor has been thinking about it. And more often than not, directors do the opposite. I mean, I've worked with Robert Altman and his actors improvise everything. I find that more often than not, an actor isn't giving the thought that you gave to that line, to that word. And given their own devices, they'll make a hash of the scene. That said, if I listen with an open mind, and if an actor really wants to make a change, and I'm not quite sure, I'll say, okay, I'll tell you what. Do it once my way, and then we'll do it your way. Some actors are very suspicious of that, and they say, oh, well, you just go to the editing room and choose your way. But that's actually, which, well, we choose, I choose the best way. No, that's not true, actually, especially on this last film, and I had two 16-year-olds, and they were arguing, you know, they were arguing passionately about some scenes and some lines, and I felt just as passionate the other way, but I gave them their shot, and maybe more than in any other film I've done, I actually went with their way, and I found that really interesting. So now when an actor says that to me, you're just going to do it your way. Actually, I have proof that I wouldn't. Do you want questions?
Where do you draw the line in terms of it's going to be done my way, period? You know, where do you draw the line?
Oh, well, that's interesting. I'll tell a quick anecdote. My first big... my second project was a big miniseries called Baby M, which is about the first surrogate mother. She was from New Jersey, Mary Beth Whitehead. And we had Jo Beth Williams, Dabney Coleman, Ann Jackson were in this, and we were rehearsing on a Saturday. It was the first Saturday I got together. I'd only done one other TV movie, and I was very green. And I had written the script, it was a courtroom scene. And I said to Dabney Coleman, will you get up on this line and approach the Jo Beth Williams who was on the witness stand? He said, I wouldn't do that. And I said, oh, no, because he's trying to make this point. So the lawyer would get up. I didn't say that. And would go on this line. He says, I'm not going to do that. And I said, well, it's really important to, and we went back and forth. Everybody's there, Ann Jackson, for God's sakes, and Jo Beth and John Shea, almost the entire cast, because they're all in this courtroom scene. And he said, I'm not going to do that. And I kept saying, well, you would. And he said, he stands up. He's from Texas. He's about 6'4", and I'm this 5'7" Jewish guy from New Jersey. And he says, let's go outside and settle this once and for all. I felt the blood rush from my head. But I also thought, okay, this is going to be a problem. This is a mini, we're shooting like 40 days. What am I going to do? And I figured, okay, we'll go outside. He'll deck me. He'll be off the picture. And now I can make my movie. So I said, okay. And he said, ah, ha, 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 just kidding. And then we went back and forth a few more times. And then he said, wait a second. You want me to get up and go on this line because of this reason? I said, yes. And he said, oh, now I get it. And he did it, And from that point on, he was the best, most cooperative. He was just, he was like, it was one of my favorite actors I've ever worked with. He was great. I don't know what, well, at the wrap party, Jo Beth Williams came up to me and she said, I just want to tell you that a lot of actors have been made to look foolish by directors. And so they don't trust directors. I trust directors, but Dabney obviously didn't. And I really like the way it worked out. So that's, you draw the line, it depends on how passionate you believe in your material.
Great story. I do the one where, like, we'll shoot it both ways. And then I just think, that's never going to be in the movie. and they go, that's probably never going to be in the movie. I say, well, we'll see what happens. They know we'll be sitting in the editing room. So here's a good exercise for screenwriters. When you're writing a screenplay, cover the names of your actors, just look at the dialogue, and see if you can tell who's speaking. Because if they all sound the same, that's you speaking. It's not the characters. So, you know, some people will speak in short sentences. Some, you can tell even the way we answer questions up here, we have different styles, different cadences of speaking. Some people use metaphors. Some people use humor. Some people think everything's always going to work out. Some things people think it's going to never work out. And you can see that in their dialogue. So that's an exercise that I do, is I take a look and say, oh, this clearly is this person, this is that person. Yeah.
Well, if we can back up just a little bit, when you're starting off, you say, you know, start structure, write every day, just get down there and put stuff on paper. Do you start with a framework? I mean, do you do a one-paragraph concept, a three-page treatment, and then put in, you know, 40 scenes and a little thumbnail of each scene? Or do you just sit down and start writing and start typing and then go backwards and work it backwards?
I think we probably all have slightly different processes, but at least two people on the stage here are strong structure fans. I outline everything and storyboard it on cards, and I indicate which is scene, first act, second act, third act. Then I color code things to see which characters are speaking, and so don't go too long without a certain character showing up. So it's all very structured, you know. But I hear you saying, like, you know, it's more organic for you.
Well, I start with a synopsis, what you might call a synopsis, and I just start writing, you know, what I think the story is going to be, who the characters are, how it's going to play out, all of that. Sometimes it's in three pages, sometimes it's in five pages, but I have a little bit of structure. I don't, you know, improvise everything. What I was saying before is, for me, once the story starts going, once I'm into the page 30, you know, which is a big leap, you know, in the script, you know, it seems to start writing itself, because you start thinking of what the characters would say. If it's a professor, how would that professor talk? If it was the guy that's the cab driver, how would the cab driver talk? And again, the internet just provides me with so much information that helps me when I write.
Yeah, so I've done it both ways. Sometimes you just go organically, and I always need to know the beginning and the end. The end is what gets me to the end. If I don't know the end, you can write forever, and that's another bad thing, is so I find it really hard cutting, because I fall in love with everything. So you should know where the end is, and the end should be somewhere around 100 pages. I have often, especially when I get stuck, I work with index cards, and each card is a scene. This especially I would do when I was doing TV movies, because there's a 7-act structure, until they added more commercials, and then it became an 8-act structure. But you know how much time you have, and you know how long a scene is. I remember when I first started timing scenes that I would see in movies that I really liked. And, you know, they were anywhere, well, now it's very different. But at that point, you know, they're about a minute, minute and a half, maybe 2 minutes. Now they're probably, you know, they can be just a shot. But so you start to add up. Okay, act one has got to be about 20 minutes. But now if you're using a traditional 3-act structure for a feature, and you're shooting for a 100-page script or a 109-page script, you just divide more. Well, but the first act now is about, like, what, 13 pages, I'm told, which is crazy. Used to be 20, 21, or 31, and 90, and 13 pages. So, but anyway, you find out the structure of films that you really like. I mean, watch them, study them, you know, and say, okay, oh, this is where, and when we talk about structure, something happens that turns the plot and makes you all of a sudden, oh, I wasn't expecting that, and then it propels you forward on the in the next direction. And often it's like the protagonist, your hero is going in one direction, then something comes and knocks them off their way, and they go in another direction. So you basically plot it out. If it's 13, I had a big fight with some guys who came on, who brought in some money to my picture, and they kept saying, you need to cut your first act, it's 21 pages, you can't have more than 13 minutes. And, you know, you work somewhere, it's not an exact formula. Every project is personal, and you got to make it work for that. But the index cards really help focus me sometimes, and I can throw out the cards and don't have to write the scenes that I know aren't going to be in it. Yes?
How do you come up with a great title?
Knowing that it might be changed 6 or 7 times by the time it comes out.
I sometimes have good titles. I have a TV pilot that's going out about guys who go to trade shows for a living and sell escalator handrails. And it's called Stand By Your Booth. And I love that title, and it seems to fit. But this movie I was having some trouble with, so I just put it out on Facebook. Hey, this is the story. What do you guys think? And a variety writer from Vancouver gave me the title. So that's how I worked on this picture.
I can't tell you. The title just seems right. This one happens to be about a boy who goes to find J.D. Salinger because he's in love with Coming Through the Rye, and he grows immeasurably through the movie, so it's called Coming Through the Rye, which is actually the name of the poem that Holden Caulfield recites in Catcher in the Rye. But they're all different. Everything, you know. And again, it may be changed.
And I can speak to this, the changing of it, if nothing else. I came last year and picked up a film called Of Mind and Music. I don't know if anybody saw it. It was a beautiful, beautiful film. And Joaquin Almeida, Sharon Lawrence, and Ingenue. Why have I forgotten her last name? Anyhow, it was called Una Vida. And it has incredible artwork with these just beautiful New Orleans jazz purples and blues. And the artwork is just so lively and gorgeous that you just fall in love with it. So you have to go see the movie. And it was a good movie. It was a very nice movie. And I met the young director because it's one of the reasons I come to film festivals is to pick up movies. And he came up to me and he goes, Pat introduces us. And I said, hi, you have to change the name of your film. And he looked at me and he said, it's nice to meet you too. Right, he's from Baton Rouge. And he's right now preparing for a tornado. I got a message just before I came here. But the point was, it's a beautiful title. It's the lady's name in the film of Una Vida. But of course, everyone walks in, and I always query people in the lines. I'm very subversive when I come here. I go into the ladies' room after I screen a film and listen to what everybody has to say. If they don't have anything to say, I ask them. The ladies' room is a great place to hear what people really feel about a film. And they don't allow me in the men's room, so it's the only place I can go. So also in the lines, you know, why do you want to see this film? What is your anticipation? Just casual conversation. It's not like I'm a newspaper investigator. And most of the people said, well, you know, I'm hoping it has subtitles because I don't speak Spanish. So and I got it more than once, some sort of answer like that. And I explained that to them, and they were very in love with the title because it was the lady's name. But it did have the subtitle of a story of music in the mind. And I flew to Louisiana and said, let's chat. And we changed the title, and it's in release, and it's doing wonderfully. It's just coming into release. So it's booking nicely. You can't see it yet, but it's booking very nicely. And that's important. It's really important. I did want to add one more thing about the writing. It's titled Of Mind and Music. And it's the sweetest film. It's just, it makes you fall in love with jazz and people. And it makes you, my partner said, oh, I think it's going to be depressing because it has an Alzheimer's issue going on in it. And I said, yeah, well, you got to watch the film because it's not depressing at all. It's so uplifting and wonderful. As a matter of fact, one of the neuroscientists that wrote it uses the film in his educational seminars around the world right now. So to help people understand that this isn't all bad news, that life is can really be very beautiful. One of the things I wanted to speak with, too, about the words and being true to the words and writing the words, a film we have coming up this week called Memoria, which, as I said, is one of James Franco's. He gave the writers a lot of leeway. And the director tells me that, of this film, tells me that she has a scene where there's a bunch of boys, senior high school age boys, and they're sitting on the curb, and they're skateboarding. They're at a skateboarding park kind of thing. And she said, and she gives them an instance, like an improv instance, because she didn't know how to write the scene. And she said, so here's the instance, then you two get in a fight, and then you two throw your skateboard, and you comment on it, and just let me see what it does, because I'm not sure the scene's right. And it's a very, very powerful scene. It's very emotional. The guys did a really great job on it. So I get it back to distribute it, and I'm in my office, and they're doing what we call, because you see them all the time now on YouTube, and if you're putting a film on someone's, you know, TV show, you want to have a clip, you know, clip 10 seconds to 30 seconds, and they always cut them one way or another. So we're in the first place, I tell the director, I said, okay, well, we're going to get an R on the film, so I'm just going to go ahead and prepare everything as an R. And she said, really? You can't get a PG? I said, well, no, honey, they say the F word about every sixth sentence, you know? She said, well, like, show me. So I cut this one scene. I go into digital, I have them cut the one scene of them, and by the second or third sentence, I've counted four. And I went, okay, you get one from, and maybe another one if you can sneak it through from the MPAA. So understand if you're writing for an audience, if you're writing for an audience, and some people are, if you're writing for art house, ours are harder to sell to an art house than a PG or a PG-13 or anything like that, because some people don't want to sit through that dialogue. Now, fortunately, I have very young people working in my digital department because they're the only people that know what they're doing anyhow. But she actually tried. She said, I can get this cut down so you can use this scene. It's a great scene. And I said, I'll bet you lunch you can't. And after about 6 minutes, she came to me and went, yeah, no. So give that some thought when you're writing. Be true to the dialogue if you know that you're going to be true to the dialogue and that's the rating you're going to get. But don't kid yourself. Yes? Exactly. That's the new format, is they show the movie to get you intrigued in it. Now, I find this as a distributor, so I'm speaking to it from experience. I have bookers that get 300 films a week. You're not the only game out there. I have bookers that get a lot more than that. I can't even remember what went to Sundance, but wasn't it 4,000 films this year were submitted? 4,000 films. Okay, how many films? You got to book in 2 hours for a film, even if it's an 80-minute film. So imagine going through 4,000 films, and they screen every one of them. And I'm sure, I didn't ask Pat how many he had this year, but I'm sure it's a lot of submissions. So understand that when you're trying to sell your film to a theater or a cable channel or a TV person, that they're seeing 300 films a week that they may or may not even see because, A, they'll like the title, or they won't. They'll like the cast, or they won't, which is things you can't control the cast as a screenwriter, even though you would like to. So they'll look at maybe 20 minutes of your film. Very seldom do they watch the whole film. Sometimes they'll look at the first 10 to 15 minutes, and then they'll cut to the last 10 to 15 minutes. And I know this quite well because I deal with these people for 30 years now, and it's gotten worse and worse because there's more and more films out for them. So the reason they're using that break is because they don't have time to have your main cast and your headings at the front of the film. Nobody has time to waste on that. They have to get you into the film. Something has to happen that intrigues you. Then you can run credits over it, and then you can tell your story. Does that answer your question? Yes, behind her.
You said earlier that you come to look for films. Do you also come to look for scripts?
No, we don't produce. We used to produce, And I'm of the belief that you can do one thing really, really well, or you can do a bunch of things pretty nicely. And I find that babying the films that we have, because we only do independent feature films, and they take a lot of work, that we can manage about 12 films a year, plus or minus, and I want my team to be totally involved and submerged in what we're doing. And for my brain to go out and have other divisions, it just didn't work. I just didn't feel, I was tired all the time.
I just want to say a word about structure. So starting out, structure is very, very important to know what kind of structure the movies that are being successful have. But then there are a lot of movies that don't follow structure that are quite successful. So there's a movie out now, a Canadian-Irish co-production called Room. Has anybody seen Room?
Oh, yes.
So two-act structure, okay? And halfway through the movie, they get out of the room. So if you were writing this for Hollywood, they'd say, no, you have to get out at the end, and it's a big weepy moment. So, but it's also extremely hard to do that well. I'd say 99 out of 100 people, directors, would not have been able to make that movie as good as it is. So it's really important to know what structure is and to know how you're doing and whether your movie is taking off and it's going to capture people's imagination or they'll be bored. But you don't have to, no one would ever advise you to write beat by beat and have these things happen at a certain point.
Let's take some more questions. Let's start with you right there in the third person in on the second row. You know, it works really well, and I love to do this because you're going to have to pitch stuff sooner or later. So stand up. Let everybody hear you. It's okay. It is indeed, and what you have to decide about all those beautiful words is how they're going to be delivered so they're best understood. So if the character is going to deliver them, if they're going to be written on a piece of paper, if it's going to be on the side of a bus, you know, however you want to deliver those words is what's going to get your audience.
It's like writing a haiku. You've got to condense it all down and just, I find myself going through a script and just cutting out the ings. And it just makes a difference. The script just starts to, you just cut out every unnecessary syllable and get it. And you want to, you want the reader to just keep, just flow right down the page. And he wants to turn the next, or she wants to turn the next one and the next one. A lot of flowery words. A script should have a certain, the page should have a certain design, a look to it. And I'm not saying now you got to worry about what the page looks like. But basically, if you can capture, if it's a fast-moving scene, you want the page to be very sparse and a couple lines and a couple lines of dialogue. But sometimes sometimes you want the reader to slow down a little bit, or if the scene slows down a little bit. But man, the more you can cut, the better off you'll be, the more success you'll have.
Yeah, there's always someone reading it, and readers like to see a lot of white space on the page.
They feel excited. They feel like they got a bonus. Oh, my God, there's a page with not many words on it. I can get through it quickly.
Yeah, screenplays are the one form of writing that really are a blueprint. They're not the thing. They're the idea of the thing that somebody else is going to create, and it's a blueprint, and they have to be able to build the structure in their head. You can't do it for them. It just has to be simple so that they can imagine it. And if you write some fiction and you can do that and enjoy the words, it's like a little treat. But that's not what this is about.
So I just want to build on what Jim said. So you have to keep in mind who you're writing this for. And you're writing it mostly for readers. You know, if you want to get it done in L.A., if you're doing independent, you're reading it for people who are also very busy. And so when they see a big block of dialogue or a big monologue or big chunks of writing, they tend to want to go and do something else. So a line of thumb a lot of writers I know do is they don't have any more than three lines in the action. So that keeps it. That's one trick to keep it flowing.
Here you go.
Okay. Well, I'll practice my pitch.
There you go.
My name is Mike.
Let's hear it.
At the age of 20, I ended up in Africa working in the middle of three civil wars. I worked with Cuban mercenaries, Russian advisors, South African commandos, wrote a book. Came out in 2010. I had to wait for someone to die before I could write it, and I wrote it mostly for my kids. In the last 6 years, people have been saying it needs to be a screenplay, needs to be a screenplay, and dozens of people. So I get up, like you said, write every day. I get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. I'm a doctor now. I see patients in clinic. Before I see patients, I write. I've now got the 110-page script that a friend of mine helped me write, but, you know, I'm not the next great American author. Where do you go from there? How do you take it from that screenplay that you've written that might be very rudimentary to the next step of finding an agent, of getting it to a person, getting someone interested in it. I can't believe there's not a good story in there somewhere because it was published as a book, but, you know, I'm an unknown.
That's a great question, and if you can send it to Hollywood, chances of it getting made are like that. And when I decided I was going to make my first feature film, I felt like this thing will spend 2 or 3 years, people passing it around, people who can't say yes, will pass it around, and finally it'll never get made. And so I went on the internet, how do you, you know, get independent films made? And basically, if you want it made, make it. And so basically I looked up how to make an independent film, how to start an LLC, how to write a business plan. It's all there. It's fantastic. For $99, I got the whole template of a business plan, how to make it. I wrote a 40-page business plan. That took about a month to learn and to do. I got investors. If you want to make a movie, and then my agent told me at the time, he said, the only way you're going to get this done is to be like a racehorse with blinders on, and you're not let anybody stop you. You say every day, I'm making this movie. And it'd be great if you have a partner who also reminds you of that in the morning, a partner meaning a loved one, because it can get really discouraging. Rejections hurt about 5 times more than acceptances. You just got to keep going. And so if you want your movie made, that's my advice. Now, you're also asking, how do you judge whether the script is right and the script is good? And I guess just show it to people you care about.
Yeah, and listen to their remarks. Even though you say, that's not what I want, this is what I do, try and separate yourself from your story, your tragedy or your wonderful life story, whatever it is you've written. Try and separate yourself from that, as hard as it is, because everyone's writing from their heart, not just their brain. And try and separate that and listen to that criticism. Sometimes you will actually find something and you'll be scratching your head, right, and saying, I didn't think of that. So that's how that's perceived. I wrote it this way, just like your direction was, you know, I'd like it done this way, and here's why I'd like it done that way. Here's what the audience will perceive when they see it.
Just a note on knowing when your script is ready. So I don't know if you guys write comedy at all, and this may work with drama, I'm not sure. But part of my process all the time is that after I have a really good, I write the first draft, I give it to a writer-director friend who I really trust, he gives me notes, I write the second draft, and then I invite a bunch of actors out to have a reading. And I invite about 30 people out, 15 of which I know and I like their sensibilities, I know they'll be very critical, and 15 people I don't know, I've never met. And we have a reading of the screenplay, and when it's a comedy and it's not working, you know it. You know, people are fidgeting, I'm shrinking, I'm wishing I was somewhere else, why did I write that? Because when you're in your basement writing it out, you're laughing, you think this is the funniest thing ever, you know, I'm going to say there's Anchorman 4, but then you play it in a room, and it can be dead. Or something you thought was kind of boring, an actor will bring something to it and bring it to life. So for me, knowing a script is ready is when you put it in front of some people and you see what the reaction is in the room.
Yeah. If you don't have enough or friends that can do a reading, then you can't do that. And that's a very good thing to do. I did that with Hybrids, and we had a reading with a bunch of actors, but it took place in Los Angeles, where there's a lot of actors that were happy to come and do the reading for nothing. If you don't have an agent and you don't know anybody in the business, like most people that start out writing, you have to go through this horrible experience of submitting when you think it's ready. You could give it to your friends, they could read it, they're going to tell you it's wonderful. But you have to go through this horrible experience of submitting to different screenplay competitions. And that's almost like buying a lottery ticket, because you never know who's going to read it, and you'll get rejection and rejected, and all of a sudden someone will like your screenplay. And when you enter some of these competitions for a few bucks more, you can get what's called coverage. And this is the people that read it will give you notes on how to make it better, what's wrong with it, what you can do to make it better. Or you could actually go and find online people that do that. You pay them to read your screenplay and give you feedback on how to make it better. It's a long, long, hard process. Like I said, I have 8 finished features. All but one has gone through that process. It's getting more expensive now. When I first started entering into screenplay competitions, it was $25, $35. Now it's $50 and $75. So you really want to, you know, research which competitions you want to get your screenplay into. And some are just kind of almost scams, you know, and some are very well respected. And you have to look those up.
You know, I'm going to take some questions, but I want to share this with all of you because it's occurred to me in listening to some of your questions and some of your answers that you may be reading things from the internet that are how-tos and taking classes that are probably exceptionally wonderful classes, and you should do all of that. But my favorite piece of advice to you, and I'm telling you, if you don't do this, you're not serious about writing a screenplay. There's a book called Adventures in the Screen Trade by William Goldman. It's the Bible. It is the absolute Bible. It's entertaining. It's humorous. I promise you, you will not be disappointed. Once you read this book, you will decide if you want to write a screenplay or not. And it's called Adventures in the Screen Trade, William Goldman. Just look up William Goldman, and once you see everything that he's written or that he's been a script doctor on, you'll know why I'm recommending this. If you bring it down to your level, everything he says applies. And you'll laugh at the same time. So that's really good. And while I'm here, I'm going to make a plug for this, because this is not mine, so I'm not really sure if that's a plug or not. But there's this wonderful software called Writer's Dream Kit. Everything you need to write the story of your dreams. They are sponsoring the festival. I must tell you, it's still in its packaging. I haven't opened it yet. But I think if they've taken the initiative to give this away at the festival, that they feel that it might be worthy. So you might want to research that and look at it and see if it's right for you. I'm not telling you to go buy it. I'm just saying that I think we should honor the fact that they think it's worthy. Yes? So
they're giving it away?
They give it away to me.
Oh. it's ironic because they give it away to the filmmakers who are already,
already
writing. So.
But yeah. Yes. No, I would not recommend submitting them to film schools. And that's because every film student has their own project they want to work on. So I don't think that values you. But to their note, too, if you don't have people and friends to read your screenplay for you, which is a fabulous idea, by the way, every single city has a community theater. And those community theater people are looking for something to do, something new, because they're really tired of doing Chekhov and Ibsen and Fitzgerald and Tennessee Williams. And even though those are the fabulous words, they'd like to read something fresh and new. And they will be happy for the price of donuts and coffee to sit and read that for you. And they will have a good time. And you'll get to listen to them and go, oh, I hated that. Or, oh, yeah, that's an idea, you know. But every community has a group of people that will do that. Often if you take it to your local college, too, and ask the drama teacher, they'll put together something like that because they're there for the experience and they like reading something fresh and new. Okay, you had a question down here somewhere. Thank you.
Well, you introduced it. I've been thinking about software. One of the issues the issues that I've heard about submitting things to readers is it has to be in a very specific format, and you know, you can get rejected just because you're not realizing that it has to be formatted this way. And there's a lot of software out there these days that helps you do that. And I was just wondering if any of you folks use such things, have any feelings about hated
Final Draft.
Yeah, the industry standard is a program called Final Draft. And it has a bunch of, it's got like 30 templates of every TV show or that you like, or just a standard screenplay. And if you're really good with the function keys on your computer, you can really help design it so it's very quick. And but the other thing is to buy some screenplays. That's the, my first screenwriting class, we had to read screenplays. And you can buy them online and see what they look like and see what the structure is.
Yeah, you can even get like Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. I think you can download it for free, right?
Right.
Yeah, and that is then you'll be introduced to William Goldman. That is like one of an epitome of screenwriting. Does anybody here hate what I just said?
No.
Because it's excellent, excellent screenwriting, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
Well, William Goldman is he's the god of screenwriting, yeah.
And there's the, now, what is it, the black? The blacklist. You can get screenplays through there, too. And there's numerous websites where you can go and get information. There's actually one that's now starting to get a little more recognition. It's called the Independent Screenplay Writers Association, the International Independent Screenplay Writers Association, which will give you all kinds of free information.
One thing I want to add to your question about who do you show it to, and when you're showing it to friends, actually, I told you to show it to friends and relatives, but most of them are going to say, oh, that's really nice, it's really good. So you have to find people that you know are going to tell it like it is, and they're not a lot. You know, even people in the business, oh, I liked it, it's just not for me. So I'm lucky enough that I've been in the business long enough, I know other screenwriters, and they'll be honest with me. And producers and directors. But that's important, is to really get honest feedback. And then it's a tricky thing. It's threading a needle, because there may be some things that some people don't like, and but you know in your gut that that's what's right for the script. I mean, and not everybody, this is something I really learned on this picture, because it's so personal and painful. That you have to realize, no matter how great a movie is, the best, The Big Short, or Nebraska, or Trumbo, a good portion of those people are going to say, I didn't like it. Not everybody likes every film. Even the top grossing, the Academy Award winning films. I mean, it's amazing how many people don't like the top Academy Award winning. So how you juggle it, how you decide, it's almost like the thing with the dialogue, with, you know, how passionate you are to stick with this. You don't want to shoot yourself in the foot. On the other hand, not everybody's going to like your material. If you get a consistent feedback about the same points, or people just consistently don't respond to it, maybe that's a clue. But it's a real juggling act.
I have a lot of questions here in this second row, so let's just start at the end and move this way. Well,
can you hear that in the
I'm
back?
I'm a distributor. Okay.
Repeat.
Her question was about there's a film that she saw here at the festival called
The Great Alone,
which is about the Iditarod and one man's struggle and his journey. And he's now actually going to try and take it to Netflix and get straight distribution. I have experience here, so I'm going to speak to it, and then you guys may as well. Netflix, people in the industry, Netflix, Amazon, everybody in the industry, Hulu, all of them are seeing hundreds of thousands of films. And they don't necessarily take them from just people. They'll take them on a recommendation. They'll take them from me because I'm a distributor. So I'll call and give them an exclusive, 6 month exclusive or something, and they love me because now that means it's not on Showtime. But if you give it to them, what do you have to sell them? Because if they don't have a star name in your film, they don't care. So it's like the hardest thing I have to tell people. If you don't have a celebrity name in your film, Netflix does not care, Hulu does not care, Showtime does not care. Doesn't matter what the film is, they don't care. And even a lot of films that you pick up and they go, there's no name in there, there is. It's somebody's daughter, somebody's niece, somebody's cousin, right? And you just maybe not recognize the name. But trust me, it is. Yes?
I want to talk a little bit more about presenting your pitch and log line and how long it should be. I think that's something very important for anybody who's here who's a screenwriter. You're going to have to pitch it. So how long do you think it should be?
What, the log line?
Well, I love people who will bring me their films and say, I don't need a log line.
Wow, that's
good. Right. No, we don't need a log line. Take that off there. We don't really need a log line. Okay.
Yeah, the pitch.
Okay, explain what the log line is.
Go ahead.
It's a one-sentence description that you might read in TV Guide.
Or maybe two.
two of them.
Or maybe two short sentences. It should give the essence of what the film is about, or at least it should make people go, oh, that sounds interesting. I want to know more about it. Now, the pitch is a whole different thing. Here's a pitch for a film. It's years ago. They walked in. They said, we got this story, and it's about twin boys separated at birth. One of them will be played by Danny DeVito, and the other by Arnold Schwarzenegger. That's all they had to say. And right away, oh, God, I want to see that, you know. So, yeah, the log line is really, really important. And again, you can go to the Internet. There's people that will help you write your log lines.
Or you can just go to the Internet. I mean, when I was going to these film festivals, some of them want a log line, or they want a log line and a 20-word synopsis or in a 50-word. So, you know, you go on and you look at a bunch of them and say, okay, and you learn how to. You do that. All this stuff is on the Internet. It's unbelievable. Yeah. The Internet is unbelievable.
Yeah. For writers, it's...
Yeah. I actually took a course by Hal Grossman. I'm sure you've been screenwriting you. I'm almost finished with my... I'm writing an Adam Lee film. So, I mean, it's got songs in it. That's so nice, because you can make them say whatever you want to. Yeah. You can't fight that.
I just want to mention a resource that would have the answer to virtually any question you've ever thought about screenwriting. It's a podcast called Script Notes. And Script Notes is John August and Craig wrote the Hangover movies. And they talk about log lines. They talk about everything we talked about here. They also do something called the 3-page challenge. You can send in your first 3 pages of your screenplay, and they'll go through it line by line and give feedback. So it's a very good way to learn about what's happening in the industry in terms of what people are looking for and what people are producing.
Yeah, and there's another thing that one of those, I forget which one it is, it could be Script Notes, but they'll give you a log line and ask you to write the screenplay. And it's a competition. So you read the log line, and then you write the 30 pages. Generally, that's what they want. And so there's so much out there. You just have to get out there and find it. And you were so right about formatting. Unfortunately, that becomes a big problem. You could have a great story, and a reader gets in. It's not formatted the way they think it should be. Chances are they won't even read it.
How about some people in the back? Do you not have any questions at all?
Okay. But you have to stand. There you go. William Goldman.
Yeah.
All the executives in the LA read it.
Yeah.
Or Sid Fields.
My Bible.
Story by Robert McKee.
Yeah.
He was actually in the parody of the movie Awakening with Nicolas Cage. He was played by, who was played by? Adaptation. Yeah. Adaptation. But anyway, it's been around for years, and he basically outlines the story that the most common structure of a film.
Another, so he was saying, they asked the screenwriter's Bible, and he's saying it's a story by Robert McKee. My Bible, but it was, you know, shortly before that, Sid Field, and it's called Screenwriting. But his structure, you know, he that was back when you were turning in 120-page scripts, and your act breaks were at 30, 90, 30 and 90. So,
but still very relevant today. There's a lot of stuff in there. A
lot of great stuff in there. It's
people he just mentioned, you can find them. They get together, Fields and John, yeah, McKee, and they have conferences for writers. I went to one in Los Angeles a number of years ago, and it's very, very helpful. And if you look online, you can find out where these conferences are, and they move them around all over the country.
Yes, right here in the second row. Well, you watch Die Hard, right? So, I mean, you can go all the way from there to something like Room, which is very, very personal, and yet you're still sitting on the edge of your chair when you watch this movie, right? Because you don't know what's happening, and you don't know what's next. So to heighten the drama can be actually showing the action, or it can be actually not showing it, so we're all wondering what's going to happen, but they might be able to give you more on technique.
So is your question, how much can you change and still call it a true story?
That's
right. Well, I don't know the exact percentages, and I wrestled with that with this film. I called it originally because I didn't want to get sued also, and we were worried about the Salinger estate, so we were calling it inspired by a true story. We had a lot of lawyers we had to deal with in order to get what's called E&O, Errors and Omissions Insurance, that would back us up in case we got sued by Salinger. I was told I could call it a based on a true story. So there's
well,
a lot
we
of...
use in distribution based on a true story almost all the time. We even did, who's doing the film of Africa? We did the film of Half a Yellow Sun based on the book, which she was involved in. So, of course, we could actually say, you know, based on the true story, because it actually was based on no one was there. So we're not sure how true the story is, because you always have to interject things from characters when no one could have been there actually in the midst of the war or whatever, exchanging that specific dialogue. So that's a really good one, based
on
the true story.
Yeah, I don't think we gave you the what to call it, but we didn't really give you the formula of how much can be true and not true, and I'm not sure. I'm not sure anybody is, really. I mean, it's up to you. You'll say, okay, you know what? This is still my story. This is still the essence of my story. And you'll be the judge.
Way back there. Yay. Look at those hands waving. Stand it up. Yeah, both.
I just put intercut between at the top, and then I have the dialogue go, and you make sure both characters are called off screen or on off screen or off camera. But at the very, that's how you solve it. Just say intercut this phone call.
Yes, in the hat.
Yeah.
I have no experience. I don't do animation. But I do like the fact that your characters don't talk back to you and change your dialogue.
Yeah.
In the sort of back up here to the right.
What
Direct for Broadway. Write for Broadway.
One thing is you do a lot of listening in on people's conversations.
That's what I was going to say.
You know, you listen in and you're at a coffee shop and you hear people talking the way they talk, and we all steal dialogue that way. We write things down and say, oh, that was really good. I'd never come up with that. Or I would never talk like that. And so, you know, I saw a play recently. One of the characters talked in a certain way, and I'm writing a pilot, and I thought, that's a really interesting way to talk. So listening for me is a great way to help your ear.
And one of the things, when I said write what you know, I've been assigned projects that I know nothing about, but then I researched them. I had to write a project for a movie about an adult person who was illiterate and had never learned to read, and then finally went to learn to read. So I went to literacy groups and I talked to these people and who were willing to talk to me. I had to write a screenplay about a developmentally disabled young man, but I didn't know any. So I went to a workshop and hung out for weeks, and then you know it. So when I say write what you know, at least, you know, if it's not your own personal experience, go and research it. And that's how you find dialogue. That's where I get my dialogue. And I get, sometimes I just don't even know what to do unless I research it. Because it's stealing. Really good writing sometimes is just plain stealing from...
Yeah, and everybody does it. Yeah. Everybody does it. All the famous book writers do it, screenwriters do it. Everybody does it, but it's a different kind of stealing because you're working it into your own play.
And what I would, if I had to write young dialogue today, high school dialogue today, I think the only way I could do it, I mean, I could make a stab at it, but I think my high school kids would give me a lot of grief. I think you got to go hang out at a high school for a couple of weeks and listen to the kids.
I have this film this week called... Now,
they talk differently to me.
I have a film here called Burning Bodhi, and there's a millennial generation. And our screenwriter was asked that question just yesterday. And he said, well, I wrote it, and then I gave it to my son, the shit detector. You know, and I thought that was really, really a bright thing to do. And he'd say, we wouldn't say this, we wouldn't say that, people don't say that, you know, that sort of thing. This is way too young for our generation. And probably if you have someone in your family or immediate group or, you know, again, a theater group or something like that would be probably good people to query that and run that by. Yes?
Something that hasn't come up yet that I think was my biggest learning experience is conflict. It's like, you know, I spent 20 years getting out of conflict, helping other people not to. Then when I take screenwriting, you have to have conflict.
Yeah, I think I learned it from Sid Field. I think he described, you're sitting in a restaurant and you're having a conversation with the person you're with, and all these people are talking around you and you're not paying any attention to them until you hear, I never said that. Yes, you did. And all of a sudden you hear a fight. You stop what you're doing and you listen to that conflict that's going next to you. So especially, a great way to get out exposition, sometimes you just have to get out backstory. And if you just tell the backstory, it's just immediately everybody's eyes glaze over. But if you could do it through a fight, through a conflict, that time that you did that, and you make a fight out of it, it becomes interesting. So,
and you can do it with a minimum amount of dialogue. Minimum amount of dialogue you can do it with.
I'm going to remind you all of what those of us in Hollywood call the famous orgasm scene. And she's sitting there sitting in the coffee shop, and she, right? When Harry Met Sally, and while we're all sitting there laughing at her, the punchline and the conflict is when his mother says, which we don't know is his mother, the lady says, I'll have what she's having. And that's a whole different kind of conflict. But again, and if you don't have that beat there and that deadpan, then you don't have it. You could completely do that scene differently, and it wouldn't have what we would call conflict. So it's friendly, it's funny, but it's still conflict.
Yeah, and you don't have to explain it.
Right.
So did we answer it, or we just say,
yeah, we're gonna
do
take,
it?
Yeah, we're going to take one more question, because my...
Have to have it.
No.
No.
No. I'm finished with my tea, which is the signal that we're finished with our session. So that's how I always know. So if there's one more question... They are real. They're all real.
And I mean, they're smoking cigars and they're drinking whiskey and things. I'm like, what do really successful writers do besides hide themselves behind the screen and type?
Smoke cigars and drink whiskey.
Do you drink a lot? Do you party? Do you meet each other?
I do what you just said. I sit alone behind a screen and see sometimes nobody for a whole day or two and think, oh my gosh, where's at least the postman or woman? I love getting together with my friends, but I don't have a big writer circle. That'd be great, but
actors do that. Yeah. Actors get together. You'll find the top guy and B actor or whatever, and they have groups. They get together and they play poker all the time.
I actually do belong to screenwriting groups, and I just joined in Film Fatale, which is now the women are gonna finally come into their own, and. I find it incredibly helpful to have other people to talk to because it is a lonely and difficult thing to do. So I think if you can find a group of like-minded people, share your work, give each other deadlines, you know, talk about how hard it is, I think it's incredibly helpful.
Do you find it's easy to collaborate when you're screenwriting with another writer?
There's two kinds of writers, those that do and those that don't. That's it. There's nothing else. There are people who actually just play off one another, and there are people who have to sit alone in a room, unplug the phones, the TVs, the whole thing. I have a friend in Malibu. She has a downstairs area in her house, and she rents it out to people to screenwrite. That's all she does. She said it's the best rental. It's better than an Airbnb because they never make noise. They're not partying. They're not playing music. They're just the best. She says she's rented it to a team, and the team, of course, acts it out. So she would prefer singles. But got anything to add to that? Because I think you either write as a team or you don't.
I write
solo. Yeah, if you're a TV writer, you learn to write as a team almost all the time.
I write solo, but I fantasize how great it would be to have a writing partner. You know, you read about, you know, writing partners. I think it'd be great, but I've never had
fabulous.
That opportunity.
When it works, it's fabulous.
Yeah.
You guys, you've been a fabulous, fabulous audience. I can't believe you stayed all through all of this. And you had such great questions. Thank you so very much. I'll be back playing here again tomorrow morning. I'm not sure why. If you have individual and personal questions, you can grab them as they leave the stage, I promise.
Pages and I'm done with my screen.